What's going on, Skullbrains? Welcome to another episode of Skullbrain TV, and in this episode, let's see what dangers face our heroes as we continue our journey along the Ancestral Trail.
When he who is the Chosen One shall tread upon the ancient path and battle there to overcome
the forces of the dark.
The Ancestral Trail, an epic story of myths, magic, and monsters. Book 3, Baal, the giant spider caught in a sticky web of evil.
Okay, in the last episode, our heroes met a new ally, Merkit, and they recovered their very first life force pod. So, let's see how the story continues. But, before we do, have you seen the Ancestral Challenge for this week? If not, go and check it out here, and then come on back. Alright, let's do this.
On the third day, beware the silken ways, by evil spinner spun. Yellow orbs that hasten days, destroy when serpent comes. Some may perish, some feel pain, tribulations not in vain. Three will tread these paths again to save the precious one.
In the eerie silence that followed the high-pitched whistle, Richard looked up, almost afraid to open his eyes. Evil laughter snickered down at him, and what he saw made him feel sick. Towering above the ruined thicket was a monstrous spider. Normally, he was not afraid of the things, but this was as far from the ordinary bathtub variety as you could get. Two thick, hairy legs held the thorn bushes apart, while two baleful red eyes glowed down at Richard. The spider's mouth formed a cruel sickle, bordered by vicious-looking pincers. Then Richard noticed even more eyes on the spider's head, flickering alertly in every direction. As he gaped at the enormous creature, Merkit shouted urgently, "Get out of the thicket! I'll deal with the spider!" Richard did not move. He was still in a state of shock. "Go! Now!" Merkit cried. "Orkin, get them away!" While Orkin hustled Richard and Melek back through the thorns, Merkit drew his sword. It swung upwards in a silver blur, travelling faster than the eye could follow. Left, right, it carved in a shining arc that sliced neatly through the spider's front legs. The creature reared up with a howl of agony, and the bushes snapped back into position. In their midst, where seconds before had been an opening, there now hung two severed talons. Merkit scrambled through the thicket to rejoin the others. "That was Baal," he panted. "I've run into him before. He's quick and he's deadly. I cut off two of his legs back there, but it won't slow him much. He'll soon grow more. Our only chance is the trees. If he catches us in a clearing, we're dead. Follow me." Merkit darted lithely through the forest, twisting and turning in an intricate maze that would have thrown any pursuer off the scent. Several times he stopped to let the others catch up, but as soon as they arrived, puffing and panting, he was off again, a dappled spectre amidst the foliage. Richard was amazed at Merkit's professionalism, and wondered how Golan's forces had managed to lose with born survivors like the Leopard Man on their side.
"I think we've gone far enough," Orkin suggested.
Merkit stopped and looked back. There was an instinctive rapport between the two soldiers. "Yes, you're right," Merkit said. He listened, ears cocked for any sign of pursuit. There was nothing, not even a bird call broke the silence. "We must get our bearings and find a way out of here," Merkit went on, cleaning his sword on a handful of leaves and sliding it back into its scabbard.
"Richard, take the Pathfinder while I look at the next riddle," Melek said, taking the Book of Prophecies from his back. "It may help us." "Beware the silken ways by evil spinner spun. Yellow orbs that hasten days destroy when serpent comes. Some may perish, some feel pain, tribulations not in vain. Three will lead these paths again to save the precious one."
As Melek read aloud from the ancient pages, Richard swung the Pathfinder until its point shimmered gold, and a deep green rose through, almost to the handle. It was pointing straight at a huge clump of bushes.
That way, Richard said. As they moved closer, Richard saw that the bushes were not normal vegetation. They were dry-looking, greyer and denser than their surroundings, and the branches were brittle and covered with thorns. Yet they bore luscious yellow berries that beckoned temptingly. The fruit looked so good that Richard reached out to pick one. "Don't touch those!" Murk had cried. "It's gripewort, or killer sunrise, some call it. The berries look good, but if you eat them, you're dead. They contain a metabolic poison which accelerates the aging process beyond belief. Your whole life is crammed into less than half a minute. For a few seconds, you have the strength and energy of 100 people, and then, burnt out, you shrivel and die. It's a horrible fate. I once lost 10 men to gripewort." Drawing his sword once again, Murk had chopped at the bushes to clear a path for the others to follow. He worked at arm's length, careful to avoid the berries. Cautiously, the three tiptoed after him, moving slowly as Murk had chopped at the branches. The bushes went deeper than they had expected, and it took some time before they reached their end. After a while, the four stepped into a large clearing. Richard's heart sank. The Pathfinder had mailed them. This was clearly Baal's territory. Cobwebs festooned hideously from tree to tree. Here and there, large cocoons of silk testified to the fate of those who had been lured here before. Tears of frustration stung Richard's eyes as he heard Golan's voice murmuring a warning over the faint rustle of leaves. "Baal must have these traps dotted all over the forest, just waiting for a victim," Murk had exclaimed. He walked up to one of the cocoons and slid it open with his sword. A wizened figure, hands held defensively before its face, crumbled out to the ground. The dry snap of bones as they hit the ground drew Murkat's attention. Looking down, he saw a small, intricately carved badge. He picked it up. "The mighty Muldoon," Murkat exclaimed, recognizing the shiny object. "He was a great warrior, a landsman, wrapped in tartan, with the wildest, reddest beard you've ever seen. This badge was handed down over generations, and was meant to have magic powers. He told me what they were one night, but I was so tired I couldn't remember a word he said." Murk had tossed the badge to Richard. "You might as well have this, though it didn't do much for Muldoon." Richard pinned the gold emblem to his tunic. It was worn with age, but he could still decipher some of the strange script around its rim. He was about to thank Murkert when there came the same dreadful whistling he had heard while hiding in the thorns. Then there was a hurried trampling noise and Baal surged into the clearing.
"This time, measly creatures," Baal wheezed triumphantly, "you won't get away."
For the second time that day, Richard was transfixed by the spider that loomed over him. Its mouth seemed crueler now, its pincers snapping more viciously. In the red eyes, he caught an unpleasant, gloating expression. "Back to the bushes," Murk had shouted, plunging swiftly into the opening he had carved. The others tried to follow, but it was too late. Lacking Murkat's lightning reflexes, the three were easily caught. From beneath Baal's body spooled a stream of thin, sticky silk. It lanced through the air, wrapping all three in its clinging embrace. As they struggled to get free, yet more of the stuff shot out to envelop them. "Help!" Melek cried as the glutinous strands tightened around him. Being smaller than the others, he was soon immobilized. Richard and Orkin battled against the sticky silk, but even more of it spurted out to trap them completely.
"Did you really think it was so easy to escape Baal?"
the spider screeched, looming over them. Still struggling against the sticky strands, Richard saw movement behind Baal. It was Murkert, delicately padding his way out of the trees. He had circled around and was about to attack. As Richard watched, Murkert swung back his sword. "Hey, Baal!" Richard shouted to distract the spider. As Baal's eyes swiveled and looked down towards Richard, Murkert struck. His sword sank deep into Baal's bloated body, and a gush of reeking thick blood belched onto his arm. The spider gave a howl of agony, and its hind legs buckled. Then Murkert sprang onto Baal's back, and gripping his sword in both hands, he plunged it repeatedly into the spider's hairy hide. The same sickly fluid slopped from each cut. Baal was tough, like Murkert. He was a survivor. He tucked in his legs to make a ball and rolled over. Murkert jumped clear to avoid being crushed. Then Baal's legs sprouted and the spider jumped round to face his adversary. Murkert found himself backed onto a wall of sticky web. Meanwhile, Orkin had managed to get at his knife and had cut through the silk to release his arms. It took him only a few seconds more to cut himself free.
Then he was slashing at the bonds which held Richard and Melek. For a second, all three stood in confusion, uncertain whether to run or to help Murkert. Then they headed towards the battling pair. Seeing their intention, Murkert shouted from behind Baal's bulk, "Get away! Save yourselves! I'll take my chances!" Orkin waved his hand in frustrated acknowledgement and turned to go. Richard was stunned. "We can't just leave him!" "Yes, we can," Orkin replied. "First rule of war, don't waste lives. Remember that. Now do as he says. Go!" He grabbed Richard by the shoulders, spun him around and gave him a shove in the back. "Go!" he repeated. Then he gave Melek the same treatment. As the others ran, Orkin turned to Murkert for the last time. There was a questioning expression on his face. "Run!" Murkert shouted. "If you don't, you'll waste everything. I can look after myself." As Murkert said these words, his attention faltered and Baal pounced. The spider's yellow pincers sank deep into Murkert's chest. The leopardman coughed horribly. Blood gushed from his mouth. And then his body went limp. Orkin watched in despair as Baal began to devour his victim. Then he ran as fast as he could after Richard and Melek. Baal had almost finished eating Murkert before he realized the others had escaped. He gave a shrill whistle of fury. Then the whistle took on a higher, more piercing tone, one that rose and fell in a regular rhythm. The sound carried to Richard, Melek, and Orkin as they plunged blindly through the forest. Deep in the trees, another creature was also roused by the high-pitched signal. Lotan's body stirred automatically, but his brain, still deep in slumber, was sluggish. It took him a while to come fully awake. Then he knew what he must do. His master had called, and he must obey. He must find and destroy those who had thwarted his master's will. His narrow black tongue forked over his scaly lips. His coils twitched, then he slid through the trees with deadly purpose, a seemingly never-ending length of viper with one thought on his mind, to do Baal's bidding, as he had done many times before. Lotan eased himself sinuously along the forest floor. He could smell his prey's terror. He could sense their indecision. This would be easy work. He increased his speed, fallen twigs crackling beneath the weight of his thick body. It was Melek who first heard Lotan's approach. "What's that?" he called. Richard and Orkin came to a halt. They were in a wide clearing. Over the sound of their breathing, they too heard the menacing continuous slither. Before Richard could speak, the bushes parted in front of him, and Lotan's head reared up, propelled by the impetus of his sudden dash. Behind him, his body thudded into hundreds of neat coils. "Split up!" Richard shouted. "He can't chase all of us at once!" Even as Richard turned to run, he found himself enveloped in thick, rubbery coils. He called for help. Orkin and Melek skidded to a halt. "We've got to help him," Orkin said. "But how?"
"The riddle!" Melek panted. "Yellow orbs!"
"Of course," Orkin exclaimed before Melek could finish. "Yellow orbs that hasten days. It must mean those berries Murkert had warned us about. The only trouble is we're nowhere near them."
"Yes, we are," Melek said. "I almost ran into a whole bank of them just back there. Come on, let's find them."
With Orkin in tow, Melek retraced his steps.
"Here they are,"
he said as they approached the bushes with their lethal yellow fruit. Wasting no time, Orkin took an arrow from his quiver and spiked three berries onto its tip.
"Right, let's go back to Richard," he said.
Grim-faced, Orkin tracked his way back to the clearing with Melek hard on his heels. As they drew near, they could hear Richard gasping for breath. Orkin took his bow and carefully positioned the arrow with its lethal load. Slowly, he drew the bow.
"Hey!"
Orkin called to the snake. In his barely conscious state, Richard sensed rather than saw Lotan move in response. He could not know that his bag had opened and the precious pod had rolled out across the forest floor. Melek and Orkin stood their ground nervously as Lotan recoiled. The thought of being swallowed whole by a serpent was in both their minds, but neither dared voice it aloud. Lotan reared up, dwarfing his two enemies into insignificance. He opened wide his cavernous mouth. At that moment, Orkin fired. With deadly accuracy, the arrow flew into Lotan's throat. For a second, the snake remained motionless. Then he seemed to expand. Along the length of his body, his muscles swelled and rippled. His eyelids bulged and squirmed as the poison took effect. Then he went into spasm. His whole body thrashed in fury. Bushes were felled like matchsticks. Orkin and Melek ran for cover, overawed by the power they had unleashed. Richard, meanwhile, lay semi-conscious on the ground as Lotan's tail slashed through the air above him. Soon, Lotan grew quiet. and Orkin and Melek emerged from hiding. They watched, astonished, as the snake's skin wrinkled into folds. His face bagged and fell in, and his eyes spewed streams of red tears. As Lotan's rotting gums yawned helplessly, Melek and Orkin rushed over to Richard. "Are you okay?" Orkin asked, hauling him to his feet. "Just about," Richard whispered. He felt bruised and battered, but otherwise he was all right. Then he noticed his open bag. "Oh no. The pod's gone." The others looked at him aghast. Then Orkin gave a laugh of relief and pointed across the clearing. On the ground, not far from Lotan's twitching body, was the pod. Richard walked towards it, keeping as far as he could from Lotan's carcass. He had almost reached the pod when he stopped, overcome by a feeling that he was being watched. He scanned the bushes and saw nothing. Then a thin voice came rasping from the darkness.
"You are a few paces from your treasure. So am I. Shall we see who can get there fastest?"
It was Baal. Richard thought desperately. Baal would almost certainly get there before him, but he had to have the pod. Richard took a pace forward.
"So predictable,"
Baal jeered.
"And soon you will be so dead."
And that is the end of book number 3. So, how'd you go with the ancestral challenge? Were you able to spot all of the hidden pieces? And do you think Baal was based on Bilaku or Arachne? Tune in to the Ancestral Challenge next week when I will reveal the answers. And until then, stay tuned and stay Skullbrain.